Okay, it's 5 p.m., so I guess we should start now. Okay, so hello everybody. My name is Grzegorz Piwowarek, and I'll be speaking about functional programming concepts in Java 8. So generally, I'm a software developer, probably as all of you, so let's not talk about this part, but except being a software developer, I used to be, for example, a professional Euro player. I'm a little bit retired right now, but I managed to tour around Europe and a little bit of USA. And except being for being a yo-yo player, I'm also a musician. I played in a metal band, so you can check us out. But I must warn you that basically only musicians listen to us. Okay, I work in a Polish software house, like 80 people. There is like 80 people. We basically focus mainly on ICT technologies, but recently we are experimenting with products. So, for example, we made something like Sputnik. You might have heard about it. It's like a tool that aggregates many different static code analyzers. And they, if you have like repos on GitHub and someone makes a pull request, Sputnik can automatically run all of them and immediately provide you with proper feedback. We recently made also experimented with document processing and even with board games. So sky's the limit. OK. Why did I decide actually to talk about Java 8 when it has been already on the market for like 2 years? People recently start talking about Java 9 more than about Java 8. But the thing is that enterprise applications, enterprise systems tend to live very long. And business layer usually doesn't really often want to experiment with new technologies. So some guys over there needs to do a noble job of maintaining such applications. So guys, please let me tell you, let me ask you, how many of you are actually working with Java 8 on a daily basis? Wow, that's really nice, because I've been giving this speech for a few times, and at the beginning there were like 2 or 3 people. Now it's almost like 50% of you. It's very nice. But let me ask again. And Java 7? Okay. Java 6? Java 5? Okay. I'm not even asking about 4 and 3 and 2. It would be too embarrassing. Okay, anyway, guys that have been working with Java for many years, they got a lot into object-oriented programming. They've been molded by object-oriented programming. They've been using it every day, that it influenced their way of their thinking. And in Java 8, they were introduced some concepts from kind of a little bit different world, from the world of functional programming. And those concepts can be sometimes hard to grasp for people that have been using object-oriented programming for for a lot of time. So let me describe this to you, and I hope that after this presentation, you will not have problems with understanding what's going on. Okay, so basically, what will we talk about today? We'll talk about the major breakthrough in Java world, which is lambda expressions. Then we'll look into the package, Java util function. Then we'll try to describe the very controversial design pattern, which is called the monad. And then we'll take a look about two very popular tools that we have in Java 8. And after this, there will be some time for, hopefully some time for Q&A. Okay, so let's get this started. Basically, object-oriented programming focuses on object composition, okay? We compose objects, and functional programming relies on composing actions, about composing functions, and giving them to functions and receiving them as normal objects. So in Java 8, we got a very major breakthrough, which is lambda expression. And Java now joined the most noble group of languages, very modern languages like Lisp or Perl, when we have those tools. Oh, okay, so let's proceed how it looks like in Java. Okay, so the very general syntax for lambda expression for defining an action is, okay, you can't see my pointer over there. Okay, so the main syntax for lambdas is this, what you can see. The key point of this is arrow operator on the left side, we have a set of arguments. On the right side, we have sets of actions that are associated with those arguments. And this is basically it. But this is the syntax for defining actions that are anonymous. Okay? Notice that this doesn't carry any name with itself. So if you want to have a look at the most basic example, it would be something like this, which is left argument of x and an action connected to this, okay? Which means that we are taking some argument and applying plus one to it. And notice that in this case, it doesn't carry any type information. It can be applied to any sets of arguments that, in this case, actually have operator plus defined. Lambdas come in many different forms and sizes, and this is like the most basic example. But for example, it can be something like this. There can be an action that returns value out of nowhere. On the right side, we don't need to specify only values. We can specify blocks of codes. But then in this case, we need to remember about manually returning our values. And of course, we can have more than one argument on the left side. OK, and here, as you can see, we have an example of the same lambda expression on the right. And as you can see, depending on the context, it can be either a function that represents like action performed on integers and function that performs action on two strings. It's a compilator comes up with types on its own. It's an analogy to what appeared in previous versions of Java about diamond syntax. Diamond syntax allowed us to not specify generic parameters if they were obvious from the context. Okay, and one nice feature is a feature of method references. It's a syntactic sugar for defining lambda expressions actions that are connected to the same object that is to the argument and to the value that's being returned. As you can see, when we are calling a function from the object, from the argument, this repeating this x two times is redundant. We can basically just point to the function that needs to be called on an argument. And this is how it looks like. OK, and let's look now deep inside the Java util function package. So as you probably can remember, in previous versions of Java, if we really wanted to pass some action somewhere, we would need to create an implementation, anonymous implementation of some interface. And Java programmers, in order to sustain the backwards compatibility, carried over this idea. So basically, all our functions that we use, all lambdas that we use in our code, are translated into some interfaces. So basically, when we are representing an action, we are creating an implementation by lambda, implementation of some functional interface. Functional interfaces are those interfaces that have one abstract method. Okay. And now there is a little bit boring part. During this lecture, I'll be mentioning many buzzwords, and we need to talk about them now so that we can establish some kind of communication and we can understand each other. So the very popular keyword that we will be using is a consumer. Consumer represents a certain set of functions that that take some argument, but they don't return anything. That means that this is basically a representation of some side effect. Another very important types of function, it will be a supplier. Supplier is a kind of function that doesn't accept any parameters, but comes up with a value basically from out of nowhere. This is very important because this we will use for realization of lazy init in Java. Another very popular keyword is a predicate. Predicate is some function that accepts any argument and always returns a boolean. That means that those functions will be used basically for some kind of filtering, okay? Checking if some kind of objects apply to some predicate. Well, another very popular keyword will be unary operator, which is a kind of a function that accepts argument of one type and returns object of the same type. So for example, it will be useful for like generating like sequences above from some arguments of the same type. And one a very important one is binary operator. This is a function that takes two arguments of the same type and returns another one of the also of the same type. That means that we will probably use this one in the context of kind of merging two values into one, or probably just picking one out of two. Okay, and now let's go into the monad. Let me tell me a story. I recently applied to a conference in Belarus, and they made a kind of code review of my presentation, and they said that everything is nice, but just don't use the word monad, because people sometimes are scared of it. They said that, oh, just call it a design pattern. I decided not to change it, but I promise that I will explain it in a very like user-friendly way. Okay, why this word is creating so much controversy? Because probably if you have never played, if you are not an algebra PhD, then you try to Google this, you end up with definition like this, okay? And this probably scares most of us. I was scared, I admit. But okay, it's algebra, right? So if it's algebra, we should be able to Google some images of it, okay? So let's check what Google Images have to tell about this. Okay, everything is clear. Okay, great. Great, it's... Okay, yes, I believe me, this all appears when you Google monad. Trust me, true story. Okay, but the truth is that that for programmers it's a very easy concept to explain, especially for Java programmers. Because what the monad is actually, first thing we need to think about is that it's a design pattern. Okay, it's a common kind of design pattern that we'll be applying in our everyday work. And it's a kind of a pattern that it's a form of a wrapper, okay? Java developers often wrap values into many different stuff. So monad is a kind of a wrapper. You put a value in it and it stays there. Okay, but what's so fancy about it? The fancy thing about it is that when you put your value into your object into your wrapper into a box, it cares on its own after some computational context of this value. It might sound a little bit abstract, but let's talk about some concrete example. So imagine a box that deals with values that can be nullable. Okay, imagine that you can put some value into a box, some reference, and totally forget about if they are nullable or not. Then you could just perform some actions on this value. Don't care about if it exists or not, and then just take this value out of the box and play with it like nothing happened. Okay, this is what we'll be basically doing. So this is kind of a box that we put value in, and it accepts some kind of actions from us. It accepts action from us as a manager. We tell him declaratively what to do, and then this box does it for us. And the whole magic happens during the act of unpacking, of taking values out of the box. Okay, so why do we really want to care about this? So basically, if we are getting rid of all of the unnecessary, for example, null checks, there is a lot of boilerplate. There is a lot of boilerplate removed, okay? We get rid of it from our code. We can focus on essence of our code, on what we actually want to do with those values. So we get rid of boilerplate. When boilerplate is gone, we increase drastically the readability of our code, and its complexity is much smaller. So okay, let's now take a look at an example of code from Java 7. With a value that can be nullable, okay? We need to perform a lot of null checks, and as you can, this is kind of code that our friends from Python or other languages laugh at, okay? When two guys that code in Python talk, they show some example like this and laugh at Java, okay? Well, what's more, guys from Groovy or Scala also laugh at us, but not anymore. Okay, so as you can see, except for the essence of the code, we have a lot of null checks, okay? Which in this case are a boilerplate and essentially just white noise that clutters our code. So if we were to rewrite this code using some monad, okay, some functional concepts, it would look like this. But let me tell you honestly, at the beginning I was scared of it. But look how the structure of code changed. There are no null checks, and now code looks like more like a list of things, more like a list of things that you need to do in order to get from point A to point B. Okay, let's go further. So, what actually do we need to have to call something a monad? Well, monad is an algebraic concept, so we cannot really like translate it one-to-one to programming. But so for Java developers, we can imagine this as some kind of a class, parameterized class that holds some value inside. In order to call something a monad, we need to have a unit method, which is essentially some method that allows us to put value inside. It can be a constructor, it can be a factory method, all you can think of, basically. And the most important thing is a bind method, which is usually called map or flat map. This is the method that, as you can see, accepts the function. It accepts the function, which is an action that needs to be performed on underlying value. And this is very important. And now, but let's just take a look at its signature. As you can see, let's take a look at return value. Return value is some kind of monad with type R, but the type accepted is a function that takes object of type U and translates it to R. So as you can see, that somewhere in the box, somewhere in the background, this value R is being translated, is being put again into another monad. So here comes the problem. And what happens if we actually if we provide our monad with an action that already returns a monad, okay? We end up with something really not really nice, okay? We end up with a monad of type R, okay? This is not something that gives us any benefits. We don't benefit from situation. It's just a clutter, it's just a problem because we need to keep unpacking such a construct. So how to get rid of it? The solution is very nice. Actually, the solution is a method flatmap that accepts, as you can see, it accepts in signature, this time it accepts a function that returns already a monad. So it doesn't repack anything into a monad again. This is actually this signature appears in an original like method definition, but usually we end up using the map one. This is why I decided to mention the map as the most important one for us. Okay, so let's just look at the practical side of things. In Java 8, we got three tools like this, three monadic tools, but basically two of the only three. And basically, on everyday basis, we will be using about two of them: optionals and streams. They also you can use another. So this is very important to know it. We have also Computable Future, which is a very powerful tool for us in computing, but it doesn't really use the same conventions as optionals or streams. So mentioning Computable Future could be a little bit confusing for all of you. So let's just stick to optionals and stream for the beginning. Okay, so let's think about optionals, what it is. Remember the example when I told you about null checks and boxes that get rid of null checks? This is exactly this. Optional is exactly this, what I mentioned. It's our tool. It's like a manager that where you put value inside and we give it actions. And everything is being performed, and we don't need to worry about if this value is null or not. So a very good analogy would be to think about Schrödinger's cat. Okay, you put a cat inside, and you don't know if it's alive or not. But you can tell it to do something, but we'll get to know if it did it when we actually open the box, this is where the magic happens. Okay, so let's see how optional conform to those three things I mentioned earlier. So of course we have optional, which is a parameterized type that can hold a value. We have also a unit method, which is then we have two ways of putting values into optionals. Those are two static methods: of nullable if not, and of. Of nullable is the one that we want to use every day because this is the one that can accept a null. Method of can be used only if we are 100% sure if this value exists. this is a very special case, which is basically used when we are implementing some interfaces that returns optional, but in our implementation we can be sure 100% that it exists. Then we don't need to use this nullable version. And of course, there's the most important, the bind method, which will be called and map and flat map. And this actually, those names you will be hearing everywhere, not only in Java, but in many different languages, in many different tools. So it's good to remember this. Okay, but if this was kind of everything that we could do, you know, I mean, putting values inside and taking them out, that would be pretty boring. So, but hopefully many those tools were enhanced by Java creators. So, for example, in optional, we have one additional tool, which is the method filter. And this method accepts a predicate instance. And this allows us to check if underlying value in an optional is true or not, according to this predicate. If it's true, it goes further in the pipeline, like nothing happened. But if it's false, since that point in our chain, value is being treated like it doesn't exist. So it's really nice. So we get rid of null checks, but additionally we can perform some additional checks on those values. Okay, and now the most important thing, the act of taking values out of the box. Okay, so the most like primitive way of doing this would be using method get. This method get is very specific. It throws a no such element exception if value in the box is null. So basically, we don't really want to use it often because if we use it, we need to be aware that it's basically a syntactic trigger that allows us to translate null pointer exception into no such element exception. So we need to be very careful if we decide to use it. But what we'll be using on daily basis is, for example, or else. Or else allows us to specify a default value that will be returned in case of the value absence. Okay, it's very nice. But look at some problem. Look at the problem that there is a normal reference. And if you want to return some value, that's a result of like very heavy computation, very long-lasting computation, it will be painful, okay, because we want to avoid if else, but we got stabbed in the back because we are getting additional output, we lose a lot of time in order to compute the value that might be never returned. This is the possible problem. But let's look at another one, or else get, which accepts supplier, okay, which is basically an action, which is an action that returns a value out of nowhere. Oh. So if we really return a default value that's a result of a very long computation, we need to use supplier. Okay, this is like a very primitive way of implementing lazy init in Java 8, and it's very important to remember this. Okay, if value doesn't exist, we can also throw a custom exception, and in such case we can use or else throw method. Or, for example, if we want to just perform some action, if this value exists, we can use if present. So far, so good. Okay, and before I proceed to streams, let me talk about one problem. That, for example, for me, when I started playing with Scala, I had a lot of problems, okay, because at school and everywhere I learned pure object-oriented programming, and transitioning to this was painful for me. And I noticed that many people have the same problem, and they often try to grasp, understand something. They think they understand, but they are afraid to use it. And sometimes when they are using it, they want to stop using it as far as possible and get back to their comfort zone. And let me show you what can it lead to. So here we have the example of code that I showed earlier about Java 7 code. There is the same code rewritten into Java 8 style. And there is a Java 7.5 style, okay? This is mean basically, it's written by a person that actually knew something. This person was aware about the existence of optionals, but they were so used to like typical Java way that they used it how they were used to, okay? So I just want to tell you that it, of course it works. Of course it works, but it's not how it was designed to. And here, as you can see, it's a much more serious example. The previous one was just painful to look at. But this one is not only like monstrous, it's also very, it's much slower in comparison to the original one. If you were to rewrite it into a proper way, it would look like this. Okay? So I suggest you to just spend some time on it, learn it, and I'm sure that you will benefit a lot from learning those concepts. Okay, so let's just proceed to streams, the most powerful tool in Java 8. Java 8 is a kind of a box that where you can put sequences of elements, and you can totally forget about the necessity of like iterating over them. You totally forget, you can forget about nested for eaches and operate on collections this way. But this is a very serious example because we have so many additional methods, additional tools that you can use. Let me show you most of them. Okay, so let's start, let's see how streams conform to this monad idea I've spoken earlier about. So of course, stream is a parameterized app, it holds some values inside. And now, if you want to put some values inside, we have a lot of different methods. We can met static method of from class stream, where we can put single or few elements. If you want to create like a stream from the whole array, we can use arrays.stream. It's also a static method. And the most important one is a instance method stream from the collection interface. This is very important because this is, look, it's an instance method, okay? So if we are holding some reference to some collection in our code, we can write .stream, and now this whole beautiful gate of magical functional programming world opens to us, okay? And we can use this whole concept on this. So this is the most important one to remember. And of course, when we are talking about bind function, we have map and flat map as in the whole, as in optionals and in many, many different languages. Okay, so let's start from scratch. This is probably the basic example. Okay, we have a stream of a sequence of three elements, A, B, and three strings, A, B, and C, and we let's say we want to declaratively print them all. So we can just simply write for each, give it a function to write them down. Okay, nothing fancy. But let's say that we want to do something more with it. Okay, let's say we want to uppercase all of those strings. Okay, so that's all we need to do. We basically add a one step in the middle, okay, with an action which tag accepts some strings and returns its uppercase version. Okay, but let's say that we want to add some string to it. Okay, so we are introducing another map. Okay, and look, and as in example with optionals, we can notice that this looks, you don't have any forages. You don't have clutter in your code. You have only essence and only list of elements that need to be done with a single element in order to an element in order to achieve the desired result. So basically, you can just take your pen and paper. You can write your algorithm. Okay. So what would I need to do if I wanted to transit from like a normal string to an uppercase and postfixed version? Okay. Then you can just write, okay, I need to uppercase it, I need to apply a postfix, and then print it out, okay? And as you can see, this is really nice to read. You read it as just like a list of things. Okay, and now let's look at a very nice example. We have an example of imperative code of finding prime values. As you can see, there are so many places where you could make a mistake, and if you write it in a declarative way, it would look just like this. This is a bigger font, but as you can see, there are multiple lines, and here you have basically a one just broken into three. Okay, so I think it's worth being aware that such things can be done. Okay, and now a very important thing about streams and optionals and how they work with each other. Why it's important? Because let's look at this. We have some pipeline, we have some chain of processing. Let's say we take some stream from people, we filter them, we perform some mappings, and then let's say we want to take just a single element out of it. Okay? In such case, we are using findAny method, and look, what's really important? That the Java creators, that API creators, thought about us, okay? They were caring, and they made find any method return as an optional, okay? So it forces us actively to think that, okay, we are processing some collection, but we are not 100% sure that there will be at least one element that that we are looking for. And as you can see, our else throw method at the bottom comes from the optional class. Okay, and now let's talk about streams, about two very important characteristics of it. The first one is a lazy initialization. Why it's very important? Because let's come back to the previous example. And now I often encounter people who ask, okay, Grzegorz, those streams are nice, but look, you wrote so much code, you took a whole collection of people, you filtered all of them, then you extracted addresses from them, then you extracted cities from them, then city names, and all of this only to just come up with one element. And when I just nest for reaches, it fails fast, okay? I get result immediately without any additional actions to be done. And those people are mistaken, because due to lazy initialization, we make sure that streams never actually touch any elements that doesn't need to be taken, okay? In such case, if you have such code, it's being processed vertically. So what would happen in such situation? Stream would take first element from the collection, then perform filtering, then perform map, and another, and then immediately return it, okay, without touching any other elements. So it's very important that we are not sacrificing performance for a nicer code. Okay, what's also very, very important is that streams are non-reusable, okay? After you use them once, they can't be used anymore. And it causes a lot of... So we basically don't want to store them, we don't want to send them to other people, we don't want to try to serialize them, oh no. We need to remember that when we want to process, it's just a layer abstraction over computations. So we need to remember that if we want to compute something using streams, we need to create instance only for this particular computation. Don't store it, forget about it. It will throw an exception at our faces. Okay, and due to nature of lazy initialization of streams, we have some concept called intermediate operation. Those are operations that basically change the definition of a stream, but doesn't really force it to look to touch any elements in the collection. So what's very important? If you go to Stack Overflow, you will notice many people having problems like this. People that tried to print elements from a stream, and they decided to use a map function, and they are crying on Stack Overflow that oh dude, nothing is being printed out. The problem is that what they did here is they changed the definition of a stream. Okay, they changed the definition of a stream that from a normal stream of three elements to a stream of elements that performs a side effect in the middle. This is why it's very important. It causes a lot of problems for people. Okay, and now the most important thing, the act of stream consumption, which is basically, we will be basically collecting our elements to some other collections, but this is the act of actually of unpacking our elements from a monad at the same time. Okay, so the easiest way of consuming streams is just performing some action on every element, and this is where for each is where we can use for each. And now the most important, like the method for streams, is method collect. That allows us to collect all of the elements to some another collection. Okay, those can be sets, lists, maps, or those maps can be sorted. It can be collected to just one element. Basically, sky's the limit. If you go to GitHub, there are so many of tools for collect that you can find basically anything you want. I will talk about collect later a little bit more. Okay, one very popular way of stream consumption is method reduce. It's probably, you might have heard about the concept MapReduce. It's the idea is taken from it, and reduce is being used to like collect all of the elements to one single one. Okay, so we are either picking the, and this method, as you can see, accepts binary operator. Okay, so we are reducing the whole our collection to one single element, either by picking the like one of them, one of two, or one, or just merging them together. What's very, very important is we need to remember that when we want to reduce our perform reduce, we need to supply it with a binary operator that gives the same results for regardless of the order of elements that are being placed in binary operator. Okay, so for example, summing all of the elements is a good idea. Okay, because if you sum A and B or B and A, it doesn't matter. But division would be a bad example. Okay, because if you divide A by B and divide B by A, you get different results. It's very easy to remember this. Okay, and also there we have some shortcuts for like checking if all of the elements in the stream conform to the certain predicate. Okay, we can use all match for this. We have also method animatch that can check if any elements is returns true for a certain predicate. And we have also non-match. We did the checks if all of the elements do not conform to some predicate. Also, we have two methods, like find first and find any. We will use them for fetching just one element from the stream. And there is, at the same time, actually, they might look like pretty similar things. But look, streams at some times can be parallelized. Okay, we can use different threads from processing them. And we went, and then the first element of the actual collection, not always, it's not always the same. Okay, because it's all up to how which threads are processing which elements and which is being returned first. This method find first assures us that it's always the original first element of the stream being returned. And we use find any when we don't really care. Okay, we have also method count that allows us to just count all the elements in a stream. And we have method toArray that allows us to just repack the whole stream into an array. For some reason, I don't know why, for some reason, I think it should be like a collector method, but for some reason it's like one level higher. It's good to remember about this. Okay, and let's look now at the example of a stream reduction. So we are taking some stream of people, we are performing some map operations on it, and then we are reducing by picking like the biggest string. Okay, and look again, Java API creators thought about us. Look, because if we are reducing the whole collection, we have no guarantee that there is at least one element there. So the second map function, it, they are returning optional for us. The second map operation comes from optional, not from stream. So it really allows us to not think much, okay? We can forget, we can focus on what we want to do and not how to avoid null pointers. Okay, and now let's talk about different ways of collecting streams, okay? All of those examples we can use with collect method. So we can collect everything to list, we can collect to map, to set, or to any collection. But what you can notice here is that they don't mention actually what implementation is being returned. So basically, when we are thinking about list to map or to set, we want to use it where we don't really care about implementation. Okay, though in those cases it's array lists, hash map and hash set, but we want to use those shortcuts when we don't really want to we don't care about the implementation itself. But when we actually care, we need to use toCollection method. toCollection collector accepts the new instance of the collection that we want to collect into. Also, we can pick the minimum or maximum value by doing collection. This is basically just the same can be achieved by using reduce. Very nice. There are some very nice methods for joining strings. Joining method can join our strings together. We can specify prefixes, suffixes, or separators. This is very useful. No more Guava for this. A very nice example of collector would be partitioning by. Partitioning by accepts a predicate, okay, and it returns us a map which has boolean in a key and list of values in value type, okay. So what does it return us? It returns us a map that has in the keys true and false, and all objects from the stream that were conformed to the vectors. You end up with very nice. With code that is very nice to read. So just if you look at the last line, you can just read it. Okay, collect to list. I think it's very nice. Okay, and streams or optionals are not tools that we can just use in everyday work. All of Java APIs just transist to it. Those tools appear in many different contexts. Okay, so if you have any string, for example, you can stream it. Use stream to go through all of the characters in a string. You can browse directories by using streams. You can generate now random numbers using streams. If you have spring data, you can and repositories. They can return optionals on stream or streams. So basically, it's not just a new tool for you to play, but this is something that all of the libraries or frameworks guys start using. So anyway, if you decide to not use it on a daily basis, you will still be forced to, because there are so many new additions to Java APIs. Okay, so if you generally like the concept, you can just take a look at javaslang.io. This is a project of one German guy that digs much deeper into the concept of functional programming and makes the whole redefines the whole collections API for Java, makes it all much more like Scala. And actually, if you follow me on Twitter or something, I will be giving a talk soon about this on JDay, for example, in September. Also, there is one very important thing. You might have some problems with processing of checked exceptions in lambda. When you happen to have such a problem, then you need to check the another link. This is the library we developed in our company. It was internal. We didn't plan to publish it, but we decided to publish it, and now all of you can just don't worry about checked exceptions in lambdas. Okay, so that would be this. Thank you very much. And if you have some questions, now it's the time to do this.
Thank you for your talk. What are your best practices working with parallel streams?
Can you repeat the question?
What are your best practices working with parallel streams?
Oh, parallel streams, very very difficult topic. Actually, in Java 8, we have two types of streams. One is sequential and one is parallel. I was talking mostly about sequential streams. But parallel streams is a powerful idea. But many people decide not to use it. Many people decide not to use it because there is no control of which part of the sequence is being processed by which thread. Also, you can't specify like a thread pool that's being used. It just uses static fork join pool for getting threads from. So basically, I'm in the camp that doesn't really use them. That's decide to not use them because there is not that much control over them. Okay, any more questions? Okay, thank you very much.